Pilgrims on the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us line the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but as those who've gone before us, let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly love. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. May the fire of our devotion light their way. May the our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them to the road we each must follow.
Pentecost Sunday. May you experience God's presence and strength and love flowing to you as we worship together in this way. I'm Randy Williams. I'm the minister at Glen Oak Christian Church, and this worship experience is being brought to you by the church. May it encourage you. May you be able to worship God fully today. Amen. Thanks for joining us. Now you might want to pause and go ahead and get your communion elements so that you can be ready later on in the service. We're going to pray about those and then share in communion, and it would be nice to include you in that. Thank you so much for joining us.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. Lord, He is thy help and salvation.
Please. Holy God, as we are reminded today of how majestic you are, how majestic are your ways in all of the earth, we're reminded of the beauty and the glory that are part of you, and that you share them with your creation, that you empower us to have sunrises and sunsets, for us to have glorious clouds to look at, and birds flying by, and rabbits in the yard, as we look at children and know that the joy is among us. We're thankful, Lord. We're thankful that you have counted us worthy to be called by your name. that you have counted us worthy to receive your presence, your peace, to be made in your image, to live in a way that reflects you to other people. We're so thankful for that. Lord, hear us just now as we pray in silence for those others that are watching this video. Hear us as we pray for the persons in Peoria that we know that will be watching this. Hear us as we pray for the persons around the nation and perhaps the world that will have an opportunity to see this video. Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence for those that are dealing with physical issues. Hear us as we pray for those who are battling the coronavirus. Hear us as we pray for those that are grieving, particularly the death of loved ones that we haven't been able to celebrate, and those that have died because of corona. Hear us just now, Lord, as we pray for the frontline workers. Lord God, that you allow us to talk to you, that you allow us to speak, and that you listen. That is the confidence of our faith, and it's such an empowering thing. We are delighted. We are seeking to do the job of representing you to the world even better than we do. Help us not to be negative when we go out and engage others. Help us not to be negative when we're wearing a mask that we see other people that aren't. Help us not to be negative and harsh and judging of them. Help us simply carry your grace and do what we can to make the world safer and better. Help us lead by example and lead with joy. We're praying, Lord, that you help all of us to know and to live into what it means to be one in your name. Inspire us as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture this morning is from John 20, verses 19 through 23. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain sins of any, they are retained."
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift.
silver and my gold. Not of mine would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Sunday. This is Children's Moment. So I'm out here with my little kids in the yard. You see Dax and Bella are there, my little doggies. We call them our kids. But today I want to talk to you kids about how Jesus, after he was raised from the dead, showed up in a room with locked doors where the disciples were hiding out as they were afraid. Because the Romans had just killed Jesus and they were a little worried that it might be them next. So when they came, Jesus showed up all of a sudden and said, "Hey, peace be with you." And then he showed them his wounds. And it was then that they realized that it was Jesus. So he must not have looked in his resurrected body exactly the way he did when he was walking with them. But they were amazed and they were filled with joy. And he said, "Hey, the Father sent me here and I'm going to send you out. So if you forgive sin, it will be as if I forgave sin." And you know, he actually has given that to all of us because we're all disciples of Jesus. You know, it's a beautiful day. It's still kind of weird out there. We still can't be at church together. We can't sit on the stoop together on the altar, and we can't talk about these things, but we can still talk about stuff. And the stuff we're talking about here is that Jesus sent us all out. He sent us out to spread the word, to share his story, to treat people the way he treated people. It's important that we treat our friends and our family and our neighbors and just all those that we encounter as if Jesus was treating them. You know, in this country, we're conflicted about all the racial divide and the violence that's going on. When if we just looked to be like Jesus and to remember that he sent us out, you know, a lot of this certainly wouldn't be going on because we'd be treating each other better. We wouldn't have these kinds of incidents. and we wouldn't have these kinds of reactions. So when you're enjoying some of the spring weather, when you're out, be safe, look around, but treat people the way that you want them to treat you, the way that Jesus would treat you. It's so important, kids, that we remember who our example really is. It's Jesus Christ. The Son of God is actually the one who's taught us everything we know. He taught us to love God, He taught us to love ourselves, and He taught us to love one another. And that we can only do all those things together. We can't just do one of them. We can't just love ourselves. We can't just love others. And we can't just love God. They all three go together. So pray with me, if you would, please. Lord God, we ask your blessings on these wonderful children that we're trying to show your way, that we're trying to be disciples for, that we're trying to mentor into understanding how important it is to treat people correctly, important it is to love one another, to love ourselves, and to love God, to love you so much. Help us to make sure that we do that for other people, that we love them, that we teach them, that we be nice, and that we show them the way that you showed us how to be. We do all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I got a couple rowdy kids here. I hope you kids have a great week, and we'll talk to you next Sunday. God bless you all.
Have you noticed that it's hard to tell what day it is? I mean, with sheltering in place, it seems one day glides into another day, glides into another day. Now, is this Monday? Is it what day is this? Today is Pentecost Sunday. But it's stunning. I mean, last Monday was Memorial Day, and for many of us, it just kind of slid by. There were plenty of folks that had the day off, but where did they go? What did they do? It was a strange time. And it's so stunning when you compare that to what it was like growing up in my hometown. In my hometown, I lived in Lawton, Oklahoma, which was twin city to Fort Sill, which is the artillery and missile center for the Army. If you were in artillery, you got trained in Lawton at Fort Sill. It was a big deal. And the Memorial Day parade was a massive thing. It was massive. There would be the rockets, and there would be the missiles that would come in. There were tank after tank after tank. There would be trucks and trucks and personnel transport. And there would be jeeps. And did I say there were going to be tanks? I mean, there's all this preparation. And it was amazing. Now, Fort Sill Boulevard was the big drag in town. And halfway through town, it became the 11th Street. My family's restaurant was on 11th Street, and all this material would come down the street getting ready, staging for the big parade in downtown Lawton. And so I got to see it all coming there, then I'd go to the parade, then I'd see it all coming back after the parade was way over. It was a major event. Our town was so military that one day I was at the counter serving coffee to John. John was a curmudgeon. A retired Army sergeant, once a sergeant, always a sergeant kind of thing. And in his own gruff way, he nodded his head over that way to point me to the guy standing at the cash register. The guy who was paying for his meal was Don Holman, who was a mortician in town. And Don just was standing there, and I knew him and all. But John nods his head and says, "That guy took care of my boss." I said, "What?" He said, "Yes, he embalmed Patton." So nothing would do, but I go over there and talk to Don about that. And Don that knew John, they visited back and forth. And he said, "Yes, I embalmed Patton." That's pretty serious military. Right now, honor flights are taking Korean War veterans and Vietnam veterans to Washington, D.C. to see the memorials, to participate in that. But the honor flights, are moving away from World War II veterans because so many of them are gone. Don's gone, John's gone, all these other people are they're just fewer and fewer World War II veterans around. And there are those that wonder, what does it mean for our country when all these people are gone? Well, that was a major fear, a concern in the early church. When John's gospel is being prepared, that one of the major concerns is, what does the church look like? How does it do what it does? How do we continue when all the eyewitnesses are gone? Will the church have what it takes to be the church when we lose that kind of testimony, that kind of witness? It's a major concern. At the time of John's gospel, it's a major concern because of John's health. There's a big debate as to what's going on in the gospel. Does John actually survive the writing of his gospel? There's an issue there in the 21st chapter. But the point I'm trying to make today is they're asking themselves, hear them asking, will the church survive? Will we be able to face the future? It was a question of, will we have the power, the spizzarentum? Will we have the pizzazz, the zippity? Will we have the courage? Will the church have enough of what it takes to be the church in the future? And as they ask that question, John's gospel puts it out there in a beautiful way. Now, in 1 John chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, if you read that, that's quite a testimony. Let me just read that for you. It's quite a testimony there. When it's put it this way, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, that which we looked upon and touched with our hands concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we saw it and testify to it and proclaim it to you, the eternal life that was with the Father and was made manifest to us, that which we have seen and heard we proclaim also to you, so that you may have fellowship with us, and our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Do you see how they're connecting all the dots? In John's gospel, how does it begin? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And that what's happening now is we're becoming dependent on this that was incarnate, Jesus present. Now Jesus is gone. And all those who knew him physically, historically, those who walked with him and talked with, who heard him preach, who saw the miracles, all of them, those folks, they're all gone. They're dying. They're leaving. Will we have what it takes? And so what happens in our passage today in the 20th chapter is pretty vigorous. When he had breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. So Jesus is present with his disciples on the night of Easter. And he breathes on them and he tells them to receive the Holy Spirit. And if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Now, don't miss this. You see, the church is wondering, will we have enough? Will we be enough? There's always in these discussions a movement from out exterior to interior. And they're asking individually, will I be enough? Will we be enough? Will we be able to get the job done? Will we be able to continue the witness faithfully into the future? And so to be reminded that on the night of Easter, Jesus said to his disciples, they're enough. Here, I'm giving you all the power you need. Here, I'm giving you everything you need. You've got it right here. Now, you and I follow the calendar according to Luke and Acts. And so we have Easter on one day, and then we have the time of Jesus having ministry with his disciples. We have the Ascension, and then we have a celebration of Pentecost, 50 days after Easter. John's gospel, that's one event. Jesus dies and is resurrected, and he gives power to the church. He breathes the Holy Spirit on them, and the church is born. It's all one event. You can't separate it. It's all historical. It's all powerful. It all happened, and it's enough. It's enough. Go and do it. Those that you release will be released. Those that you bind will be bound. Now, one of my favorite professors, Dr. Stinnett, would get really angry at the church. He would get angry because he said, we are so quick to condemn. We are so quick to condemn and so slow to forgive, so slow to grant absolution. He said, but that's our job. We've got to grant absolution. We've got to help people know they're forgiven. Imagine Helen. Imagine a lady that's grown up in the church. She's been baptized. She's, as an adult, has taught Sunday school, been active in Vacation Bible School. She's worked with young people in various settings. She's done all these kinds of things. And you have the nominating committee that come to her and say, we've been praying and we're thinking, Helen, that maybe you would be a good elder. And what we'd like for you to do is to pray about that and see if you can confirm that call, if you could be an elder. And Helen says, I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. I'm not even sure I'm worthy to pray about that. Hear Jesus saying to Helen, Helen, it's not about you. Hear Jesus say that to her. It's not about you, Helen. What made you think it was about you, Helen? It's about me. It's about me. You are going in my name. You are doing it in my name. You are doing it in my power. I am giving it to you. I am not asking you. I'm telling you, Helen, you be an elder and do it well. Because you already have everything you need. As we think about shelter in place, and we wonder about the church of the future, and will we have enough? And the answer, emphatically, is yes. Amen.
To rejoice, exult, revel.
To celebrate the many memorable moments of life, large and small.
Perhaps with voices raised in song.
Or hearts exploding with excitement.
Or family and friends drawn to a holiday table to raise a toast.
But how do we celebrate a truly world-changing, life-altering milestone?
Such as the welcoming of more than 1,000 new churches into the family of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ.
Since 2001, this has been the goal of the 2020 vision.
And we reached and exceeded our goal ahead of schedule through the new church movement.
Thanks to nurturing disciples like you and your generous support of the Pentecost offering.
Each year, half of this special offering stays in your local region or area to plant and nourish new churches.
The other half is used throughout the United States and Canada by New Church Ministry to train, equip, and assist church leaders at events like Leadership Academy.
Imagine more than 1,000 new and affiliating faith communities in just 20 years, living into the teachings of Jesus Christ. By welcoming the homeless,
feeding the hungry,
teaching the young,
and transforming their communities through hands-on mission and ministry.
And know that this is just the beginning.
More than 1,000 new churches and counting. Celebrate them and our faith with your continued support of the Pentecost offering and the new church movement.
So that more disciples will be drawn to our family table,
where all are welcome
and their places are waiting.
Good morning. It's time for our offering meditation and prayer. This morning's scripture is from the book of John, and it tells us about Jesus giving the gift of the Holy Spirit to his disciples before sending them forth. Today is Pentecost Sunday, and as such, I'd like to lead you through a guided meditation this morning that I'm going to paraphrase from Travis Jeffords. So as you enter into this time of meditation and reflection with me, I invite you to get comfortable. If you'd like to close your eyes, you certainly may do that, and just breathe. That fire of God is inside of you, inside your very being, placed there by the Holy Spirit. As you breathe in and out, that living water of God courses through you, flowing in streams, teeming with God-given life, bubbling up and alive with new possibilities. God is that voice that gently whispers. Whispers in the calm, in the still, in the quiet. How long has it been since you've slowed down? Since you've stopped running from thing to thing to thing? Since you've just paused and breathed and then just listened? How is that fire of God inside of you? Is it a hot blue flame, potent, concentrated, and focused, bursting forth in everything you do and say? Is it a nice red glow? Does it warm your heart and soul like a burning log in the fireplace on a cold winter's night? It may be cold around you, but this fire can warm you from within. Or is that fire faint and dim? Is it like a distant memory of something so far gone, sometimes you wonder if it was ever really there in the first place? Is it time to ask God to stoke that fire? Is it time to ask God to brush away the ash and blow off those coals until they begin to come to life again? Until they crack and pop? And until the flame begins to rise again, flickering and dancing, wild and alive. Can you think back now? When was the last time that fire burned like a hot blue flame inside of you? When was the last time you listened to that burning fire inside of you? To the living water flowing through your veins? Or to that gentle whisper? That stirring in a moment of stillness. When that fire was burning, what did you feel? Did you feel loved all the way through your being, inside and out, the strong parts and the weak parts, all of it? Loved? Did you feel joy as your eyes were awakened to the blessings that were all around you? As the whole world sparkled and danced with possibility, with creativity, and you weren't sure whether you wanted to laugh or to cry at the beauty that was all around you. Did you feel passionate? Passion for something that was bigger than yourself and what you wanted? Something God was calling you to be a part of? Something where you were confident you were on the right side of the history and truth, even if others might not be able to understand right now? When that fire was burning, what was it inviting you to do? Was it that unique, individual, God-given fire that God lit in your heart? What was it that excited you and scared you all at the same time? What was it that you weren't sure if you'd be able to do on your own, but you knew you had to do it? I invite you to breathe and spend a moment in the quiet remembering. Remembering that feeling, that burning, that invitation. Will you please pray with me? Most gracious and loving Father, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Lord, let that fire be stoked within us. Lord, lead us with passion and commitment and creativity to do the things that you would have us do in this world. Lord, help us to bring forth that spirit in us. And through the gifts of our offerings and ourselves, further your kingdom in this place at Glen Oak and throughout the world. In your Son's precious name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.
The invitation to communion seems more to me now as I think about it in our time with the coronavirus and everyone so worried. As the sharing together at the table happened with Jesus and his disciples, that's the hope for us, that we will be able to do that together in the not too distant future, that we might be able to share at table and pass the plates and touch the dishes and be with each other and not be so worried. Jesus could have been worried himself. And yet at that night, he took bread and he blessed and he broke it and he said, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." In the same way also at the close of the supper, he took the cup and he gave thanksgiving and he declared, "This is the new covenant, my blood. Drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat the bread and drink from the cup, we proclaim the Lord Jesus until he comes anew."
Pray with me, please. Heavenly Father, we love you with all of our hearts, all of our mind, and all of our soul. Give us grace to love you more each and every day, and through our words and actions, may our friends be drawn closer to you and experience the wonders of knowing and loving you. Today, as we partake of this loaf and this cup, may we draw life from you and come to serve you better. In the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for being part of this worship service, wherever you are and whatever your situation. I pray that it's been a blessing to you and that you go and live your life this week in such a way that you're a blessing to others. Whatever happens this week, know completely. Know at the depth of your being, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. This we know. Go and live in that joy now and always.
I receive your mercy. Hail, I receive your grace. Hail, I will dance forever. Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy, it falls like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling, is falling over me. Mercy is falling, is falling, is falling. Mercy, it falls like a sweet spring rain. Mercy is falling over me. Falling, it's falling, it's falling. Mercy falls like the sweet spring.